This is Concept E Classes and today we'll deal with Chapter 2 of Class 8 Social Science History from Trade to Territory. The company establishes power. So let's see what all we're going to study in this chapter. First we'll see how East India Company began their trade in Bengal and how then this trade led to battles and then the Battle of Plassey. Then we'll see how this East India Company's rule expanded over India. Inside that, we'll see Tipu Sultan, the Tiger of Mysore, war with Marathas, the claim to paramountcy, and the doctrine of lapse. And finally, we'll see how the company set up a new administration through the company's army. So in this chapter, we'll see how the Britishers came to trade and then how they established their power over the whole India. So let's begin the chapter. So the name of the chapter is From Trade to Territory. So what we're going to study is how the Britishers came as a small trading company and how they transformed to a territorial colonial power. That is how they became the rulers of the Indian territory. That's what we're going to study in this chapter. Now before the Britishers came to India, India was under the rule of Mughals. That is it was a medieval period. And Aurangzeb was the last powerful Mughal ruler who established control over a large part of Indian territory. And after his death, what happened was that all his successors were very weak rulers. Hence, many Mughal governors, they were called as Subedars. Subedars means they are like the civil or military rank given to a senior official of a Mughal empire. And Zamindars are the land owners of the Mughal Empire. So these governors and zamindars, they started emerging in various parts of India and they started establishing their own regional kingdom. So Delhi was the effective center at that time, but because of these powerful regional kingdoms emerging in various parts of India, Delhi could no longer function as the effective center. And by the second half of the 18th century, a new power was emerging over the political horizon, and that was the British. So we'll see how the British became the masters of such a vast empire. So the first topic of this chapter is East India Company comes east. So this all started in 1600 when the East India Company received a charter from the Queen. What do you mean by charter? A charter is a formal document issued by any monarch like a queen or a king as letters granting a right or a power to an individual to a corporate. So the East India Company, they received a charter from the ruler of England, Queen Elizabeth I, granting its sole right to trade with East. What do you mean by sole right? It meant that only the East India Company could trade. No other trading group in England could compete with the East India Company. And with this charter, the company could travel across oceans looking for new lands from which they could buy goods at very cheap price and then carry back to Europe and to sell them at higher prices. However, the Royal Charter couldn't prevent other European powers or companies to enter into the Eastern market. So by the time the first English ship sailed down the west coast of Africa, round the Cape of Good Hope, then crossing the Indian Ocean, the Portuguese have already established in western coast of India. So this was the route how the Britishers entered India. So this route was actually discovered by Vasco da Gama, a Portuguese explorer in 1498. Actually, Vasco da Gama was the first European to enter into India. So before the Britishers came, the Portuguese have established their base in Goa. Similarly, by the early 17th century, the Dutch too were exploring possible trades in the Indian Ocean and they had one of their base in Pulicat as well. And French traders also, they had their base in Pondicherry. So all these European countries were doing trade in India. Now what attracted all these European trading companies to India? It was a fine quality of cotton and silk produced in India. It had a big market in Europe. Similarly, the spices like peppers, clove, cardamom, cinnamon too were also in great demand. So as the demand increased, the prices at which these goods could be purchased also pushed up. As a result, this reduced the profits that could be earned. So the only way for the East India Company to survive was to eliminate the rival competitors. Hence, fierce battles between trading companies started. So what the East India Company did was that through the 17th and 18th century, they regularly sank each other's ships. They blockaded the routes and they prevented the rival ships with the supply of goods. Trade were carried out with arms, with weapons, and the trading posts were protected through fortification. They secured the area while they were trading. So this effort led to intense conflict with the local rulers. So we studied that the East India Company came east. So actually, where did they started their trade in the east? They started their trade in Bengal. The first English factory was set up in the banks of the river Hooghly in 1651. The factory had a warehouse where goods for the export were stored, and it had officers where the company officials sat. So this is an image where the local boats brought goods from Madras. So as the trade expanded, the company persuaded the merchants and traders to come and settle near the factory. And in 1696, the company, they started building a fort around the settlement. And they even bribed some of the Mughal officials in giving their rights over three villages. One of these were the Calicutta, which is the city of Kolkata as it's known today. They also persuaded the Mughal emperor Aurangzeb to issue a firman granting the company the right to trade duty free. What do you mean by a firman? It was a royal edict or a royal order, and they requested or they forced emperor Aurangzeb to issue an order for the company to do trade without paying any taxes. Duty-free trade means we are able to purchase or buy an item without paying any taxes. So this was the firman issued by the Aurangzeb. But the company tried manipulating the existing privileges, and they wanted more concessions. For instance, the Aurangzeb's firman, they granted the company the right to trade duty-free. But some of the officials of the company, they carried out private trade and they didn't pay the tax. They refused to pay, causing an enormous loss for the revenue of Bengal. So that time, the Nawab of Bengal was Murshid Quli Khan. He was a very strong ruler and he started protesting this. So let's see how the trade led to battles. Through the early 18th century, the conflict between the company and the Nawabs of Bengal intensified. So what was the conflict? The East India Company refused to pay taxes for the trade that they did privately. As a result, there was an enormous loss of revenue in Bengal. Hence, the Nawabs of Bengal, they started protesting this. Now, who all were the Nawabs of Bengal at that time? Murshid Quli Khan, followed by Aliwardi Khan, and then Sirajuddin. And each one of them were very strong rulers. They refused to grant the company concessions. They demanded large tributes for the company's right to trade. They even denied any right to mint coins. Mint coins were the coins used as currency at that time. And they stopped it from extending its settlements, its fortifications. So the Mughals had the following accusations against the company. The company was depriving the Bengal government of huge amounts of revenue. They were undermining the authority of the Nawab. They were not giving respect to the authority of the Nawab. They refused to pay taxes, and they even wrote disrespectful letters trying to humiliate the Nawab and his officials. Now, the company on its part declared that this unjust demands of the local officials were ruining the trade of the company, and the trade can flourish only if the duties were removed. And they convinced that in order to expand trade, they had to enlarge their settlements. That is why they started buying villages and rebuilding its fort. So these conflicts between the company and that of the Nawabs ended in the famous Battle of Plassey. So let's see the Battle of Plassey. When Aliwardi Khan died in 1756, Sirajuddin became the Nawab of Bengal. He was a very strong ruler, just like his father. So the company was worried with his power, and they actually wanted a puppet ruler. What is a puppet? A puppet is a toy which we can move with the help of strings. So with a puppet ruler, they could have privileges and other trade concessions. So what they did was that they tried to help one of Sirajuddin's rivals to become the Nawab. So the Sirajuddin, on knowing this, they asked the company to stop meddling in the political affairs, and he also asked to stop the fortification and pay the revenues. But the company didn't listen. So after the negotiations failed, the Nawab marched with 30,000 soldiers to the English factory that was situated at Qasim Bazar, and he captured all the company's officials, locked the warehouse, and disarmed all the Englishmen and blockaded the English ships. Then he marched to Calcutta to establish his control over the company fort there. On hearing the fall of Calcutta, the company officials in Madras sent forces under the command of a British official named as Robert Clive. And then there was a prolonged, very long negotiation with the Nawab followed. Finally, in 1757, Robert Clive led the company's army against Sirajuddin at Plassey and defeated the Nawab. The reason for defeat was that one of Sirajuddin's commander, named as Mir Jafar, never fought the battle. Why didn't he fight? Actually, Clive managed to get his support by promising him to make him the Nawab after crushing Sirajuddin. So that led to the defeat of the Nawab Sirajuddin. So this is an image where Robert Clive meets Mir Jafar after the Battle of Plassey. Now the Battle of Plassey became famous because it was the first major victory the company won in India. So the British conquest of Bengal began with the Battle of Plassey. Now the Plassey is actually a place called as Palashi. Palassi is the Anglic pronunciation of Palashi. Palashi is a tree that has red flowers that yield gulal, the powder used in the festival of Holi. So what happened after the Battle of Plassey? After the defeat of Plassey, Sirajuddin was assassinated and Mir Jafar was made the Nawab. Then Mir Jafar, on seeing all these methods used by company, started protesting. Then the company removed him and installed Mir Qasim in his place. Then Mir Qasim also started complaining, and he in turn was defeated in the battle fought at Buxar. The Battle of Buxar was actually a battle between the British East India Company and the combined forces of Mir Qasim, which was the Nawab of Bengal at that time, Shuja ud Dawla, the Nawab of Awadh, and Shah Alam II, the Mughal Emperor. But he was defeated at this battle and was driven out of Bengal, and Mir Jafar again was reinstalled. Now the Nawab had to pay rupees 5 lakh, but the company wanted more money to finance its wars and meet the demands of trade and its other expenses. Now this is an image of Mir Jafar and his son delivering a treaty of 1757 with Williamson. So by the time Mir Jafar died in 1765, the company decided to become the Nawabs themselves, as the puppet rulers were of no help. All the puppet rulers started protesting against the company. So they decided to become Nawabs themselves. And finally in 1765, the Mughal emperor at that time was Shah Alam. He appointed the company as the Diwan of the provinces in Bengal. Actually, the right of Diwan is the right to collect land revenue. So the Diwani allowed the company to use vast revenue resources of Bengal. So this solved a major problem that the company had earlier faced. What was the problem? The Britishers had to buy goods in India with the gold and silver they received from Britain. So the outflow of gold and from Britain slowed down after the Battle of Plassey. Why did it slow down? Because the revenues from India could finance the company expenses. So they didn't require any gold from Britain. So with the revenue that they received from Bengal, they could easily purchase the cotton and silk textiles. They could even maintain the company troops and also build the company fort and other offices in Calcutta. Now, company officials became Nawab. So after the company acquired more power, like the power of Diwani and authority, each company servant started acting like Nawabs. So after the Battle of Plassey, the actual Nawabs of Bengal were forced to give land as personal gifts to the company officials. For example, Robert Clive. He himself collected a fortune in India. He came from England in 1743 at the age of 18, and when he left India at 1767, he had an Indian fortune worth 4 lakhs. However, not all company officials succeeded in making money, because most of the officials died an early death in India due to disease and war. But those who managed to return with the wealth led a very flashy lives and flaunted their riches. So they were called as Nabobs. It is an anglicized version of the Indian verb Nawab. So the next topic is company rule expense. So if we observe the process of annexation of Indian state, or the process of conquering of Indian states by the East India Company from 1757 to 1857, we can see that the company didn't launch any direct military attack on any territory, but used a variety of political, economic and diplomatic methods. So after the Battle of Buxar in 1764, the company appointed residents in Indian state. Residents are senior British officials. They are like agents, and their job was to serve the interest of the company. So through these residents, the company officials began interfering in internal affairs of Indian states. Like, they decided who was to become the successor of the throne and who was to be appointed an administrative post, like that. So this is an image of the Nawab of Shujaudullah of Awadh with his sons and the British resident. So in order to bring the Indian states within the boundary of British, a subsidiary alliance was used by Lord Wellesley, and the company forced the states into this alliance. According to the terms of this alliance, the Indian rulers were not allowed to have their independent armed forces. That is, the Indian rulers were not allowed to have their own independent army. They were to be protected by the company, and the Indian rulers had to pay for this protection. If the Indian rulers failed to make the payment, then a part of their territory was taken away as penalty. For example, when Richard Wellesley was the Governor General from 1792 to 1805, the Nawab of Awadh, which was Shujaudullah, had to give one half of his territory to the company. Similarly, Hyderabad Nawab, who was Nizam, was forced to cede his territories on similar grounds as well. Tipu Sultan, the Tiger of Mysore. Why was he called as the Tiger of Mysore? There's a legend of Tipu saying that once when he went for hunting in a forest with a French friend, he came face to face with a tiger, and his gun did not work. So he battled with the tiger unarmed, and finally he was able to kill the tiger in the battle. Hence came the name Tiger of Mysore. Now, let's see what happened with the East India Company and Tipu Sultan. The company made direct military confrontation when it saw a threat to its political or economic interest. This can be explained by the case of the southern state of Mysore. Mysore has grown in strength under Hyder Ali, ruled from 1761 to 1782, and his son Tipu Sultan, ruler from 1782 to 1799. They were very strong rulers, and they controlled profitable trade of the Malabar coast, where the company purchased pepper and cardamom. So Tipu Sultan, in 1785, he stopped the export of sandalwood, pepper and cardamom through his kingdom, and he disallowed local merchants from trading with the East India Company. He also established a close relationship with the French in India, and he modernized his army with their help. The British were very furious when they saw all these rulers, and they wanted to control and crush them. So four wars were fought between Mysore and the British East India Company. These wars were called as Anglo-Mysore War. The range was from 1767 to 69, 1780 to 84, third war was in 1792, and the last battle was in 1799. It was a battle of Seringapatam, and it was only at that last battle did the company win the victory. Tipu Sultan was killed defending his capital, Seringapatnam. Actually, the company, they joined forces with the Marathas and the Nizam of Hyderabad, and Tipu was forced to sign a treaty with the British, by which two of his sons were taken away as hostages. Then Mysore was placed under the dynasty of Wodeyars, and a subsidiary alliance was also imposed on the state. This was a toy that Tipu possessed. When its handle was turned, the toy tiger rolled and the soldiers shrieked. This toy is now kept in the Victoria and Albert Museum in London, and the British took it away when Tipu Sultan died defending his capital. Next topic is war with Marathas. So even though the Marathas allied with East India Company, from the late 8th century, the company wanted to destroy the Maratha power. So with the defeat of the Third Battle of Panipat in 1761, the Third Battle of Panipat was the battle between the Maratha Empire and the invading Afghan army. So after the defeat of the Maratha in that battle, the Marathas were divided into many states under different chiefs, and the chiefs were called as Sardars, such as Sindhya, Holkar, Gaikwad and Bonsle. And these chiefs were held together under a Peshwa, like a principal prime minister who became the administrative head based in Pune. Now Mahaji Sindhya and Nana Phadnis were the two famous Maratha soldiers and statesmen of the late 18th century. So there were war between the Marathas and the British East India Company, and they were called as Anglo-Maratha War. So the first war ended in 1782 with the Treaty of Salbai. The second Anglo-Maratha War was fought in 1803 to 1805, and this resulted in British gaining Orissa, the territories north to the Yamuna River, including Agra and Delhi. Finally, the third Anglo-Maratha War was from 1817 to 19. It crushed the Maratha power. The Peshwa was removed and sent away to Bittur near Kanpur with a pension. So the company now had complete control over the territory south of Vindhyas. So in other words, we can say that this war left the company in control of most of the Indian territory. This was an image where the Marathas are surrendering to the British East India Company. Now let's see the claim to Paramountcy. So the Britishers were never enough with acquiring territories. They wanted more. So from the early 19th century, the company followed the policy of Paramountcy. It was initiated by Lord Hastings, the governor, from 1813 to 1823. Now the company claimed that by the policy of Paramountcy, it had the authority, which was paramount, which meant supreme. Hence, its power was greater than that of Indian states. And now the company claimed that in order to protect this interest, it was justified in conquering different Indian states. And this view continued to guide later the British policies as well. But this process, however, did not go unchallenged. When the British tried to annex Kittur, Rani Chennamma took arms and led an anti-British resistance movement. She was arrested in 1824 and died in the prison in 1829. Now, Rayana, a chaukidar of Rani Chennamma of Sangoli, he carried out the resistance, and along with much support, he destroyed many British camps and records. Later, he was caught and hanged by the British in 1830. Now, the East India Company, they already conquered South in east of India. Now they wanted to secure northwest. So they fought a war with Afghanistan between 1838 and 1842. Sindh was taken over in 1843. Next in line was Punjab, but Maharaja Ranjit Singh, he was a very strong ruler, he held back the company. After his death in 1839, two prolonged wars were also fought in the Sikh kingdom. And ultimately in 1849, Punjab was. The next subtopic is the doctrine of lapse. Now the final wave of annexations occurred under Lord Dalhousie, who was a governor general from 1848 to 1856, and many more areas had to be conquered. So he devised a policy that came to be known as the doctrine of lapse. So the doctrine declared that if an Indian ruler died without a male heir, his kingdom would lapse. That is, it would become a part of the territories, and many kingdoms were annexed simply by applying this doctrine. So what did the doctrine say? That if the Indian ruler died without having a male child, that kingdom would go to the company. So some of the kingdoms that were annexed by this doctrine was Satara in 1848, Sambalpur 1850, Udaipur in 1852, Nagpur in 1853, and Jhansi in 1854. Finally, in 1856, the company took over Awadh. Awadh was the region in the state of Uttar Pradesh. Before independence, it was known as the United Provinces of Agra and Awadh. So this time, the Britishers said that they were obliged or they were forced to take over Awadh in order to free the people from misgovernment of the Nawab. On hearing this, the people became very enraged how the Nawab was humiliated or insulted, and the people of Awadh, they joined the great revolt that broke out in 1857. It was a revolt of 1857. We'll study more about this in the coming chapters. So this map shows the expansion of the British territorial power in India. So this map was India in 1797. So it is at that time when the Britishers came for trade in Calcutta. Slowly in 1840, most of the south as well as northeast was annexed by British, and by 1857, most of the territories in India was annexed by the British. The last topic of this chapter is setting up a new administration. Now, as British acquired most of the territories in India, it was required to set up a new administration. Warren Hastings was the Governor General at that time. His reign was from 1773 to 1785, and he was one of the most important figure who played an important role in the expansion of the company power. So under his rule, the British territories were divided into administrative unit called as presidencies, and there were three presidencies: the Bengal, Madras and Bombay, and each of these presidencies was ruled by the governor. And the supreme head of the administration was the Governor General. Who was the Governor General at that time? Warren Hastings. Now, from 1772, a new system of justice was established. Each district had two courts: a criminal court called as Faujdari Adalat and a civil court called as Diwani Adalat. And the Maulis and the Hindu Pandits, they interpreted the Indian laws for the European district collectors. Now, this is the trial of Warren Hastings. Here, when Warren Hastings went back to England, Edward Burke, he accused him for the misgovernment in Bengal. This led to impeachment as well. So the criminal courts were still under the Qazi and Mufti. Qazi is the judge and Mufti is the jurist who was responsible for the law that the Qazi would administrate. They were still under the supervision of collectors. One major problem was that the Brahmin Pandits, they gave different interpretation of local laws based on the Dharma Shastra. Dharma Shastra was the Sanskrit text. So in order to bring uniformity, in 1775, 11 Pandits were asked to compile a digest of Hindu laws, and N.B. Halhed translated this digest into English. By 1778, a code of Muslim laws was also compiled for the benefit of European judges. Now, under the Regulating Act of 1773, a new Supreme Court was established, and a court of appeal called as a Sadar Nizam Adalat was also set up in Calcutta. The principal figure in the Indian district was the collector. So this was a collectorate, and its office was collectorate. This was a collectorate at Vishakhapatnam, and that became the new center of power. Now, what was the role of the collector? The main job of the collector was to collect revenue and taxes and maintain law and order in his district with the help of judges and police officers and darogas. So this is even maintained today. So the Britishers, they conquered most of India. They set up a new administration. Now what they wanted was military strength or manpower. So now let's study about the company army. The colonial's rule power rested on its military strength. The Mughal army was mainly composed of cavalry. The cavalry was the Sawars, the soldiers trained on horseback. Infantry, that is paidal or foot soldiers. They were also trained in archery. Archery is tirandasi, which means a bow and arrow. And they also knew how to use sword. So at that time, the cavalry dominated the army, and the Mughal state did not need any professionally trained infantry. The rural areas at that time had large number of armed presence, and the local zamindars also supplied the Mughals with paidal soldiers. The East India Company, they adopted the same method used by the Mughal and they began their own army called as Sipoi Army. The Sipoi is obtained from the Indian word Sipahi, meaning soldier. So as the warfare technology changed from 1820, the cavalry requirement started declining. This is because the British Empire was fighting in Burma, Afghanistan, Egypt, and there the soldiers were armed with muskets and matchlocks. Muskets are actually heavy gun used by the infantry soldiers, and matchlocks is a type of gun in which the powder was ignited to match. So here what happened was that by this change, the soldiers of the company also had to keep pace with the change in military requirements. Now, the infantry regiments now became important. So in the early 19th century, the British began to develop a uniform military. So here the soldiers were subjected to European style training, drill and discipline that regulated the life far more than before. Often this created problems since the caste community feelings were ignored in building a force of professional soldiers. So the revolt of 1857 gives us a glimpse in the world of sepoys, and we'll study more about this in chapter 5. So from this chapter we can conclude that the East India Company was transformed from a trading company to a territorial colonial power. The arrival of new steam technology in the early 19th century also aided this process. How did it aid it? Because before this coming on the steam engine, it took about 6 to 8 months to travel to India by sea. So the steamships, it reduces the journey time to 3 weeks, enabling more and more Britishers and their families to come to a far off country like India. And by 1857, the East India Company had virtually the whole of India under its control. So that's all for this chapter 2 of history, from trade to territory. Tune in soon for the next session. Thank you so much. May God bless you all. Take care and bye-bye.